These flags are gently powered by the wind, which is the natural ammunition used in men's air rifle. This new Olympic sport has become the ultimate sophistication of the old BB gun. But in this event, the targets aren't beer cans and bottles. The bullseye, in fact, is half the size of a BB and 33 feet away. Everyone has a different method for keeping cool during the 2 hours and 15 minutes and for keeping the distractions out of sight and out of mind. The heavy clothing absorbs the heartbeat that would be visible as they aim. Our story begins with Barry Dagger of Great Britain, who sees the target from a slightly lower angle than the other competitors. Barry Dagger has hit a snag, a score of 8 with one shot to go. His British countrymen would cheer that he settled himself with a spot of tea, tradition dying hard. Across the way, Philippe Eberle of France has blocked the French Alps he loves to climb out of his mind. Along with his cap, he is a fugitive from distraction. He is shooting accurately. The 47-year-old 4'10 marksman Dagger, like the other shooters, doesn't know what the competition is doing. There is no defense in shooting. It is a battle within himself. But he does know that his final shot was a perfect 10. Dagger was an early finisher. It would be hours, however, before he learned his fate. Not expecting a high finish, he casted a few casual glances at the other scores. The Frenchman Eberle steadied himself for the last shot. The man who hunts animals in the wild, loaded only with 35mm film, had shot with a vengeance. Philippe was not considered a favorite earlier in the day, but his steady nerves made the prognosticators wrong. He too would have to be patient, not knowing whether his leading score of 590 would hold up. Unwinding, Eberle removed his earplugs, realizing sound once again. The targets were being collected for the judges' critical eye as Andreas Kronthaler of Austria, a two-time world champion, was reaching the point of relief, the 60th shot, and an unofficial score of 587 out of a perfect 600, 4 points higher than Barry Dagger. Before the competition, Kronthaler didn't like his chances for a medal, but now everyone in attendance liked them very much. It certainly looked like an Austrian silver. Down the range was another Frenchman, Nicolas Berthelot, for whom time was running out. His unofficial final score was also 587, and it looked like a tie for the silver. But not knowing any of the other scores, Berthelot sat dejected, alone, and unsure of where he stood. There were only 3 minutes remaining, and the final few squeezes of the trigger would be nervous ones for Glenn Dubas of the United States. Despite the kind of support only his mom and dad could provide, the favored shooter would finish 15th. For all the shooters, it was lunchtime, which meant a lot more than hamburgers to the Korean delegation. Meanwhile, the judges were hard at work, making decisions that would be difficult for one Frenchman to swallow.
Stockholm, 1912. The white-bearded marksman Oscar Spahn, 64, of Sweden, still the oldest gold medal winner in Olympic history, captured the team running deer competition.
The air rifle competition, which really deserves a closer look. This doesn't shoot anything, and it won't determine whether you have a sore throat or not, but it certainly could help decide whether someone wins the gold medal or less. In the air rifle competition, remember, the bullseye is only about the size of a ballpoint pen tip. The shooters require precision. When the event is over and they've taken their 60 shots, there is a score behind them on the scorecard. But that isn't official until the people in this tent behind me say it is so. You see, their job requires the same amount of precision. They score the targets one at a time. And if there is a dispute, if they think it may be a 9 and not a 10, they call out the magnifying glass. Inside the judge's tent, the checking and rechecking is underway. One by one, the evaluators go over the 3,180 targets. If there is the slightest hesitation, a plug gauge is inserted in the pellet hole. If the plug touches the outer line, the lower score is given. If not, the higher is awarded. In this case, even with a magnifying glass, there is an obvious disagreement. One thinks a 9, the other a 10. A jury member is called in to help decide. And from there, the democratic process takes over.
One, two, three.
They don't know which competitor has just survived their careful voting process, but two out of three, it's a 10. A signature makes it official. From there, the recorders enter the results, which are then summed up by the tabulators. The top 10 scorers then receive another look from the jury, who must allow 2 hours for protests from the shooters. It is a matter of Olympic pride to these professionals that their decisions have survived all protests during the games. On this, the last day of judged shooting competition, they will find out as time expires whether they have perfected the process. It would be an Olympic first.
We did it!
For them, a gold medal kind of feeling. The judges reduced Eberle's unofficial total by 1 to 589, but it would stand for the gold medal. Andreas Kronthaler's remained intact. He would be the silver medalist. But Barry Dagger, who thought he had finished without a medal, received good news, colored bronze. Nicolas Berthelot of France had an unofficial score that would have tied him for second, and silver. It was not correct, according to the judges who placed him fourth. For Berthelot, tragedy. For France, their first gold.